Jack, welcome to the studio.
You know, you had said that before when we first opened this studio. I think I was the first guest.
You were.
And everything's spun 90 degrees, so I guess this is the 2.0 version.
Well, this is the NHRA.TV version, and we thank you for coming in. First of all, how did you select your awesome t-shirt? I love it.
This is my Tom Prock custom body shirt. And you said it's casual, right?
Yep.
So I'm looking through, I'm like, I can't wear a sponsor shirt. You know, we don't want to make this a pandering deal. And for me, casual is a t-shirt that's got some sort of racing on it. And this one was clean. I hadn't got it messed up working in it.
Did you ever see the custom body car race in person?
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. Now the interesting thing about this Challenger here is this one's got the side canard wings, which were never allowed by NHRA. That would have been a match race only. But it kind of harkens back to the days where anything went until the sanctioning body said, wait a minute, guys, that's not going to fly.
Sure. Now, when you think about, you know, Tom Prock and you see Austin Prock out there, the grandson of Tom Prock, that's pretty cool, right?
Jimmy and I became good friends when he was my crew chief, and we're still good friends to this day. And I think the coolest thing is Tom Prock's dad was a riding mechanic in an early Indy car. You know, you hate to say it's in your genes, but clearly for Austin Prock, it's in his genes.
You know, I know that fact is that when you won Chicago a couple years back, probably 2015, when Jimmy Prock tuned your race car, you asked me to go to dinner on Sunday night.
2016, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And we had that conversation where Jimmy and a young Austin Prock talked about their great-grandfather and grandfather, and Tom was there too. So that's nice that we learned that at the same time.
Yeah, and Austin's a rookie, but he's not a rookie. You know, he's kind of like a Tanner Gray. That kid's got so much car control feel and lap times and just a different form of motorsports. So when they come over and make it look easy, it's not because it's easy, it's because they're really good at what they do and they're now applying that in a drag race vehicle.
Now, if your son or daughter wanted to drag race, would you say maybe a little sprint car would be the way to go before a junior dragster? I mean, you know, it's kind of a tough decision because car control.
Yeah, the go-karts is probably the best way to start.
Yeah.
It's really affordable and lap time. The issue with the junior, well, the issue with any drag race car is there's only so many laps you can make in a certain amount of time. Where you get in a go-kart, a road race car, a dirt car, you can literally make 100 laps in a weekend.
Now, if you're going to be a bracket racer or someone who races stock, super stock, or super comp, then the junior car is perfect because you learn how to drive the finish line, which is really key.
Well, teaching at the Frank Holly School, a lot of times I would get junior racers that came in that wanted to get a big car license, and staging is staging. I mean, these kids got it. They'd already done this several hundred times, and it seems so easy because when you watch it on TV, they're race car drivers doing this, right? That's what they do as a job. But you'd be surprised how difficult it can be for somebody who's never done that before.
Yeah, it's a learning process. Now speaking of Frank Holly, how long did you work for Frank?
I never quit. I started in 1998. We reopened Gainesville, so we ran Pomona and Gainesville from 2001 to 2008, and it was pretty obvious in the recession, we're paying double the rent, not getting double the students. So we stopped running at Pomona. But I never quit. I still would go teach in Gainesville. When the class would go on the road, I'd show up. I'd do the two-seater car on location. Frank and I have done some lectures together. In fact, I just sat through a month and a half ago one of the classes at Fontana, and Frank said, you know, we got to kind of dust you off. He says, if there's a situation where I'm sick and I can't teach a class, he says, I don't have anybody to back me up. So I still do it. I miss it, and I didn't realize how much I missed it until I went back there at Fontana. Jeff Arend still works there too. And man, I met so many wonderful people, students I'm still great friends with today.
Now, in terms of some of the students you've taught, who are some of the most well-known in the sport of drag racing? I kind of know the answer.
The most well-known would be Lori Force. I signed a super comp license for Lori Force. Erica Enders. And her dad, Greg, comes up to me all the time. He goes, I just want to thank you for what a great job you did with her. And I says, listen, I don't take credit for the exceptional ones because there's some that I don't think are that great. Sure. And I'm not taking the blame. Robert Height, and Robert was everything that you would think he would have been. He was astute. He was humble. Like nobody else in that class knew who he was. And I kind of had to giggle because I'm like, you guys don't have any idea how good this guy's going to be. And I didn't know he was going to be as good as he is. Ashley Force came in and did our half throttle course. And I really couldn't tell if she had that passion for it. Because, you know, Ashley's a very reserved person.
Quiet.
Yeah, and people used to ask, is Ashley stuck up? I'm like, nothing could be further from the truth. Ashley's shy. And it dawned on me that sometimes people just misinterpret people's character and actions. But she came back out of her own dime and got her super comp license. And I think she was the impetus for Brittany and Courtney to come back and or to come in and get their super comp licenses. And I mean, there's a ton of people in the pro categories, and there's never a race I go to that I don't have six or seven sportsman racers that were former students. It's real gratifying.
That's pretty cool. Now, you know, most people don't know that Robert and Erica went to the alcohol funny car class at the same time. So there was a chance that Erica, who really loves pro stock, and I'm so glad she races in pro stock,
could have been in a funny car.
Yeah, she could have been. I mean, that could still happen. You never know.
Yeah,
down
that's
the road.
Probably the day I retire. The day Jeg Coughlin gets his nitro funny car license, I'm done. Yeah.
All right. Funny story. You know, I call, you know, Jeg the Natural, and mm-hmm. and Dave Reif, when he did the play-by-play, we kind of bonded on that name. You know, Tony Pedregon is not so sure about that because Jeg has never driven a nitro car. Now, I believe that Jeg, with the proper, you know, a couple laps, maybe an A-fuel car first, would be just so good at it. I mean, what's your thought?
I'll give you the perfect analogy. Preseason testing at Phoenix, you're going to have to date this. Antron Brown was in a top fuel dragster for the first time after a real successful pro stock motorcycle career. And back then, fans could come hang out each day there. A fan comes up to me and didn't mean anything derogatory by it, but made a comment, "What are they thinking, sticking a motorcycle guy in a top fuel car?" I said, "What do you mean?" They go, "Well, he's not going to be able to hack it in here." I said, "You don't think so? You imagine the focus and concentration it takes to get a pro stock motorcycle down the racetrack, shift it five times, lean to steer the thing." Yeah. I said, "Not only do I think Antron's going to be a good top fuel dragster driver," I said, "I think he's going to be one of the best." And the guy was blown away. He's like, "How can that be?" I said, "Because it's here, sure. And he's got it. By the way, he's an athlete too, he's got it here." And boy, was I right on that. So, you know, if you call people naturals at stuff, then you're almost saying there's no point in going to a school. Some got it and some don't. Sure. Well, being that I teach at the Frank Holley School, we strongly advocate people come to the school. But there's some people that certainly have a natural inclination for stuff. That mindset, that ability to focus, everybody can get better, but you know, once in a while you get the Sean Langdons, the Jeg Coughlins. I give Jeg a preseason warm-up, and that guy's rookie of the year and a candidate for the world championship if you put him in a good nitro car. He's just that good.
Sure. Now, you've been on the road the last couple races, but you actually do fly back in between.
Yes.
I call this
Southwest.
I call this the early summer swing. It's not the Western swing. But what is it like for you when you come home? You get home, I guess, Sunday or Monday, and what do you do?
Hey, this is way worse than the Western swing for me. I'm a West Coast guy. On the Western swing, two out of three races, I stay in my own time zone. On this swing, it's four in a row, and I'm back and forth for each one, and there ain't no nonstops out of Ontario, California. So it's a lot of changing around there. Well, I'll give you an example. I flew home Monday morning. This was our third of four in a row. I'm going to leave Thursday morning for Norwalk. So Monday at 10:30, I head home, hug the kids, and then there's some projects to go. Yesterday, I got the lawn mowed. I changed the sprinkler. I made a trip to Home Depot. Today, I'm going to go back and check the brake pressure on the El Camino, try to figure out why it's not optimal right now. There's always a list of stuff to do. We're trying to sell our motor home. My wife and I worded up an ad for that. And, you know, in between that and my 3 days off, you said, "Hey, come up, we're gonna break in the new studio." So there's not a lot of idle time, but it's a good job to have. Like when I get on an airplane and head out there, I still have to remind myself how lucky I am to get a paycheck to do this.
Now this is kind of random. What do you, now on a plane, now sometimes I work because I have to fly back and do my work, and sometimes I'll binge watch a TV show, but you know, read a book, read a magazine. What do you do on a plane? What do you, you know, you're on planes your whole entire life.
Yeah, so lately,
can you sleep on a plane?
Oh my God, I'm a professional. I am amazing at that. Usually the wheels are up and I'm snoring. And the bummer with that is when you're flying east and you're adding 3 hours and then you take a nap, then you're up till 4 a.m. and you know, then you're getting up Friday for qualifying. So I just started downloading some movies on my phone on Netflix, and I think that's kind of cool. Yeah. I'll buy some magazines, I'll take it on the plane. I'm big into like a popular science or anything that has to do with the mind. We're talking about things I do, and I've squeezed three workouts into my 3 days at home here too. So it's harder to get back into a rhythm when you're doing this in and out of the house all the time. But I also think maybe especially for me, because I'm not 26 years old anymore, it's really important to do those things that make you feel good, like a good workout. It's tough to get up the energy to go in that room and say, okay, I'm going to lift weights here for 45 minutes. But once it's done, you kind of check it off the list and you feel good about that you checked something off the list. But it's also a nice feeling to keep your body in a rhythm.
Now, how old are you now?
I am, yes. I will be, hey, wait a minute. I am, wait, oh, 15-year-old girls round their age up. I'm 52. But this month I'll be 53.
Well, you know, I've surfed with Jack, so I know what he looks like when he takes his shirt off and he's changing into his wetsuit. This guy, for a 50-something-year-old dude, is ripped.
No, so. I wouldn't say, not Matt Hagen-esque, but no. I'm the before photo when the gyms show what they could do. It's me and then Matt Hagen.
You and Matt Hagen. Yeah. Well, I don't believe Matt can catch a wave on a surfboard, though.
He'd need a bigger board than you and I, wouldn't he?
Oh, yeah. 10-footer.
That's a big dude. And surfing. I love surfing. And surfing kind of is my reset button. And you get it. And even if you're not a great surfer, you literally leave land, right? Just paddling out in the water just does something to the mind. It just kind of resets your blood pressure. I don't get to do that very much anymore.
Sure.
So certainly not in this four-race swing. There's just not the time to work it in. But as soon as we get back from Norwalk and I got a week off, I'll go out and float a couple times. And in fact, I just fixed one of my boards yesterday.
Nice.
Put that on my list. So nice. I'll go home and finish sanding that today.
You could actually fix a surfboard.
Well, I got that solar res. You put it on, set it out in the sun, then sand it down. It's not rocket science.
Yeah. I've done that once or twice. Yeah. You know, after Topeka, I paddled out. I flew home. Drove to Malibu.
You told me, Malibu, yeah.
And it was just a zen experience. I mean, and the coolest part is my Uber driver mentioned a sport compact racer just randomly. And then I met a guy in the water who was worked in television, so we were talking. And he goes, oh yeah, one of my neighbors is a former sport compact drag racing star. So twice in the same day,
small world.
A guy's came up. I mean, I was stunned. But
And you and I have surfed on the West Coast.
Yep.
And on the East Coast,
yep.
Jeff Deal. Now, Jeff Deal's a whole different class. Jeff will go out on 20-foot days.
Yeah, big waves.
Yeah, that's not for me. He and I went out one day at Newport Beach, and the thing about surfing is you don't phone ahead for reservations, and you don't request a certain size wave. You get what you get, and you don't throw a fit, right? So him and I are driving up and down Huntington and Newport, and it literally was 2-foot surf. And he's like, well, what do you want to do? I said, well, I want to get wet. I live 50 miles from the water, and I don't get to do this that often. So we had a contest in waves about this high.
And who won?
It was a tie.
Because
we both had fun, yeah.
Yeah.
But not as cool as you and he surfing tanker waves
yes.
At Houston. I'm doing that next year.
That was the best and one of the great experiences of my life. Now, you know, since we have you in the studio, we have some technology here. I want to play some videos for you, some of your great moments. First up will be from 2012, and that is at Pomona, semifinals, and you can watch on the screen right here on our TV. It'll be coming up any second here.
Yeah, and you want the backstory to this one? This is when we ran Thursday at Pomona. So we come in Thursday. I had never had an explosion big enough to put the body off the car, launch the body into the grandstands. So we fixed it overnight Thursday, came back Friday, got 3 points for low ET of that session, and wound up winning the championship by 2 points when Courtney beat Ron Capps. Now, here's the other kicker on this. So we just won the championship, but if we go down on that run and lose to Cruz, which we did, and oil the racetrack, we would have lost the championship. Really, the prudent thing to do would have been to shut our car off, but we didn't show up to lose in the semifinals. We really thought we could also win the race. Just magical. And that was such a Cinderella story. Todd Smith was a dragster crew chief, came in 5 races into the year after my whole team went over to Ron Capps' team. Nobody gave us a snowball's chance of winning the championship.
Now what's it like? J.R. Todd had the same experience this past year, you know, sitting in the car. Now, what is it like you're strapped in? I mean, I've been strapped into a race car. I mean, you can't just jump up and go, I won the championship.
Well, it's funny.
I mean, what are those emotions like in there?
J.R. reminds me a little bit of Don Perdomo. He's cool. You just never see him get excited, right? But you could see him get excited in the car. I was the opposite. I'm like, okay, guys, let's go win the race. In other words, that's done. Actually, it wasn't done because we could have oiled the racetrack, but I still want to win the race, which is why we decided to run the car. There was never a moment where we said, gosh, if we go out there and lose and oil the track down, we could lose this championship. It was, okay, championship done, now let's go win the race. And then unfortunately, our car just wore way too much clutch and we watched Cruz drive off into the distance. And it was the best loser's interview I'd ever had in my life.
Yeah, you got up on the stage, you got to hold up the big check.
Just amazing. And to get to do it at a racetrack that, God, I think my dad took my brother and I to our first Winter Nationals in 75 or 76.
Nice.
So, I mean, as a Southern California native, it was so much more special than it would be just winning the championship by itself.
All right, our next video is from 2015, and that is your dominating sweep at the U.S. Nationals. This looks like the final round. You and Robert Height again. It's always Robert Height.
Yeah, and actually win on a hole shot. As good as our car was running, and let me tell you, beating Height's always tough. Beating Height on a hole shot's almost impossible because that guy's good on every end of the racetrack.
Notice the crew chief on that one, Jimmy Proc,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, and to double up, to have won the tracks and shootout, I remember it was so hot and humid, and I'm fine in the heat, but after we'd won the tracks on Sunday, all I wanted to do was go in a pool for 3 days. And then you got to come back Monday. How about John Asher,
yeah,
right,
John
there? A guy
there,
that's
yeah.
done everything in drag racing. But to come back on Monday and have to start all over again. And I had been to the final there twice before and got beaten. Robert beat me in the final there. And everybody says Indy's the ultimate win. It isn't until you've done it.
Sure.
In other words, it's talking about how great it is to have kids. If you don't have kids, it's not that great to have kids. You don't know what the experience is like. So now I get it. After winning it, now I get how big a deal Indy is.
Absolutely. And you know, the fact that, you know, Jimmy Proc was there, you had that relationship with Jimmy. Now you're pretty much competing against him and Robert every weekend. It's pretty
interesting. I've had more crew chief than Roland Leong has had drivers.
Good one.
Yeah.
Good one.
Yeah, it's
Can you name all your crew chiefs?
Yeah, I think I could. It would take me a few minutes, but it actually starts with Jimmy Walsh back in 2005.
Top Fuel.
In the MTS Menards Top Fuel Dragster. And I have been so fortunate to have so many badass crew chiefs and good people too. Like, you look at John Medlin, he's just a rock as a human being. And Guido is a guy that I'd said hi to in the lanes, but now we're friends and you just get to dig beneath the surface there. Jimmy Proc and I hadn't spoken three words to each other in the 10 years I'd been out there. And now I consider us excellent friends. Crew chiefs' brains just work on a different level. They truly do, Lewis.
They do.
You get it.
They do.
When they walk around and they seem grumpy and unfriendly, they're not. It's just the brain can only do so much. It shuts the eyes down, the mouth doesn't work anymore because they're thinking about what to do in the race car.
Neil Strasbaugh told me, you know, Mike Green's a really nice guy, but don't try to talk to him before Q1 on Friday because he feels that the whole weekend starts off.
Posture
that's
by
that. Key, that first qualifying right. session.
But you look at the people that are phenomenal at what they do, Warren Johnson. Warren Johnson wouldn't get anybody's vote as a friendly guy at the racetrack. Warren Johnson away from the racetrack is unbelievable. He's funny.
Yeah.
He's clever. He's witty. He's the guy you want to hang out with. Guess why he's not that guy at the racetrack? Because he came to win the race.
Absolutely. The next video, this is kind of pretty dramatic. This is from Epping 2016.
Oh, and yeah, I remember this one.
We actually put this on our Crash and Burn show, you remember.
This explosion literally blew concrete chunks out of the wall there and moved one of those sections of walls an inch and a half. And I let the car get out of the groove. It started to spin the tires. You see, I'm just closing the throttle when it blows up. And I was, I was thankful I got it stopped. Right there, I'm reaching for the parachutes that, well, they're on the body, and the body is in row 17 right now. And then it blows oil all over your visor. So I'm finally going to reach up with the back of my gloved hand and wipe the visor off because you can't believe how difficult it is to see through sure. that Pennzoil 70 weight film on your visor, and you know you've blown the car up. What you don't want to do now is hit the guy in the other lane or hit the wall. And that wasn't one of my career highlights. So how about this? That was Saturday Q3. We sat out Saturday Q4. That's the only time in my Don Schumacher career that we have ever missed a qualifying session. I missed two other qualifying sessions, Indy 2005, Q4 and Q5, and we were already on the bump spot and had to sit it out with the dragster because it had leaned out and blew up and we didn't know why, and it turned out the chassis was arching, splitting the fuel line, leaning the car out. And I missed the chance in Q4 of lining up next to Chris Karamasinas. We were slated to be paired together. Ah, that would have been an awesome moment.
You would have loved that. I mean, we all know that Jack, you know, appreciates the history of drag racing as much as anybody. And, you know, if we had a trivia contest, he would be definitely in the
panel. I'd finish second to
panel.
You.
Yes. No, yes. Don't suck up after that article on Complus where you left me out.
You're so funny.
I remember those things.
Yeah, right. Now, don't let the facts get in the way of your story, buddy.
Now, you know, when you see that explosion and, you know, the fact that you got right back in the race car, I mean, it's just part of your job. But, you know, somewhere in that head of yours has got to be like, you know, this is still pretty scary.
The good thing about that was I got to get back in the next day. I wouldn't want to have that happen in eliminations where you've got a 2-week break before your next run. I had been upside down in a nostalgia funny car at Sacramento, I think it was 2009. And the next week I was back in the nitro car. I want to say it was Houston, but we're towing up in the staging lanes and I'm strapped in. And then you get the devil on your shoulder, you know, where some of the negative thoughts start coming in, and you just got to block that out and go to work. I was at Bristol 3 years ago. We tow up for qualifying, bodies up. We're at the water box. They put the starter on. They prime it, spin it over, pull the mag wires, and the thing lights up. And I'm staring at the back of the engine, and it's just rocking back and forth. And I forgot I was at work for a second. I was having such a fan moment. Like, there was this, probably lasted 3 seconds. It seemed like a half an hour, where I'm watching this engine rock back and forth, and you're just enjoying the surroundings. And then I went, it's time to get back to work. I had one other big fan moment like that.
Sure.
World Finals 2016, Q4. Do the burnout, I'm backing up, and our backup guy isn't there. There's this lady backing me up, Jungle Pam. We had arranged for her to come out and back me up from a burnout. And as she's backing me up, I'm ear-to-ear grin. Like, as a kid, I watched her and Jungle do their thing across the country, and first of all, she was smoking hot. Second of all, she was the best ever at that job. No knock on Lisa Deal. She does a phenomenal job, and Alice Bodie.
Yep.
But Jungle Pam's backing me up, and I get done backing up, put it in forward, pull up, and they raise the body. I'm like, okay, now you gotta go to work. I ran the quickest run of my career, 3.825, I think. And in the tow vehicle, all the way up the return road, the crew guys said she wouldn't stop screaming. She loved being a part of that.
Well, Jungle Pam was there because Jungle Jim, we announced the number one funny car of all time. It was the 50th anniversary of the funny car class, based on the 66 finals with Fast Eddie Shartman, and the Jungle Jim Vega was the number one car. That's why Pam was there. That was
just
a great
magical moment. You know, I still have those fan moments. I really was concerned when I started getting a paycheck for driving a car. Would it change it for me? Because now it's a job, right? Before, I fixed elevators for a living, then I taught drag racing for a living, but all that was a means to getting in my sportsman car, towing it to the race, racing it, bringing it home, doing all the maintenance myself. It was a hobby and I loved it. Well, you have to love it if it's a hobby, or otherwise you're an idiot, right? You'd find another hobby. But now it's not, and it's a job. But I still have the fan moments. I still really enjoy the sport.
That's good. Our last moment is from Topeka. You were runner-up to Robert Height at the race.
Yeah.
I like the way you slide off the car, by the way.
Yeah, well, I tore my meniscus a few years ago and had to have surgery in the off season, so I don't know if I'm going to be doing any big leaps anymore.
Ron does like the whole slide down the car still, right?
Yeah, it's pretty cool. You just don't want to mess up the paint. Our cars this year are vinyl wrap, so it's not a big deal. Yeah, it was a good race. I rolled in some, so my 29 light, I think, really would have been about a 60 light. Our car would have probably run 300s quicker, probably would have run a 393. We didn't have a 389 in our car. And that's just Height and Proc. And don't forget Chris Cunningham.
Chris, yes.
Yeah,
absolutely.
He's an integral part of that team too. They just got something special going right now. But let me tell you, I've never seen a funny car run hard the entire year long. Even going back to Force in the mid 90s, even when he was winning all those races, a lot of times the cars were screwing up next to him.
Yeah,
funny
sure,
cars
sure.
Have peaks and valleys. So yeah, right now Height's at the top of their game, but they've shown signs of vulnerability. We started strong, kind of went into a little bit of a valley as we changed chassis, changed two of our clutch discs there, and I think we're getting a handle on ours. And with the countdown deal, really the first 18 races only matters to stay in the top 10. Now, I say that, but I don't really mean that, because there's a trophy for every one of those races.
Absolutely.
Of course they matter. It's not like Major League Baseball's regular season. We have a trophy every single race. But what I'm talking about is a championship. If you can stay in that top 10 and peak at the right time and not have any bad luck in those last six races, you can walk away with a big trophy.
And, you know, there's bonus money for winning the races, I would believe, right? Is that part of your deal?
I don't get that. You know what? There's a million different ways to have a salary compensation package. The crew all gets bonus money. It's a big deal for them if we make it to the final round, and especially if we win the race. But guess what, Lewis? I get to keep the trophy.
You want the trophy.
I get to take the trophy home.
All right. Now, I want to do like a little lightning round.
Okay.
So basically it's like, you know, one or the other. So we'll do some drag racing questions,
okay.
Then we'll do some personal stuff.
And gotcha.
Then Jack brought some show and tell items, which are simply fantastic.
I dug through the attic, found some cool stuff.
I love it. So, okay, here we go. Top Fuel or Funny Car?
Right now, Funny Car. Later in my career, back to Top Fuel.
There you go. Snake or Mongoose?
Snake. Granada Hills. I was born in Granada Hills.
Big Daddy or Shirley?
Nothing beats the black car. It's got to be Big Daddy.
All right. How about Glidden or Shepherd?
Oh.
Tough question,
now you're
right?
Getting close to home. Born and raised a Chevy guy. Never rooted for Bob because he drove a Ford. But listen, at the end of the day, Bob Glidden. One-man band. Nobody ever did it better.
I agree with that. Dodge or Chevy? Now, this is tricky because you drive a Mopar, but your passion is that El Camino.
Yeah, well, my first car is a 68 SS El Camino. Born and raised a Chevy guy because my dad was a Chevy guy, but his dad was a Dodge guy. So I'm going to have to go Dodge.
All righty. Pomona or Indy? Look at the wheels turning.
You really have some great questions. Pomona. It's home for me.
Okay. Austin Coyle or Alan Johnson?
Oh, wow. They're not getting any easier. Well, look. Alan might eventually go down as the greatest crew chief in the history of the sport, but Austin Coyle is what Alan Johnson does wouldn't have been possible without Austin Coyle's my answer.
Great explanation.
Yeah.
I really like this one. Wonder Wagon or Stardust CUDA?
Oh. Wow.
That's the Don Schumacher
reference.
Yeah,
the Wonder Wagon deal was short and almost ill-fated, so I'm going to have to go with Stardust. I think that's what put Don on the map, was a Stardust car.
Now, of all his cars, which would be your favorite? I know which one I like.
You know, that little John Butera Vega.
Bingo.
It wasn't a great running car because it had so many trick deals on it. I'm sorry to get off track, but I'll give you a perfect example. Go back and look at a picture of the 1972 Walton Cerny Moody Top Fuel car. Had a dual element rear wing on it. And then they went away for 15 years. Why? It was ahead of its time. They didn't have the technology to take advantage of a superior product. Same deal with Don's Butera Vega.
All right, I like this one. Low ET of the round or best reaction time of the round?
Well, best reaction time you can fudge by rolling the car in. So I'm always going to stage thin, so it is what it is. Low ET of the round. And which sounds like a crew chief answer, but I'm always doing my best in stage and shallow, so I might not have best reaction time.
How about Jungle Jim or Jungle Pam?
Wow. She backed me up on my quickest run. I'm going to go with Pam.
Pam, absolutely. All right, now this is kind of a little selfish. Kelly Slater or John Force?
So Kelly Slater's arguably the greatest surfer of all time. It depends how you rate stuff. But I got to tell you what, John Force can do no wrong in my eyes. The fact that I get to race against that guy is a pinch me moment all the time. Self-made man, crazy in the most brilliant way I've ever seen, John Force.
Okay, this is more personal now. What do you love most about your wife? Who we met at a drag race.
She was a super comp racer. I mean, I don't know that I'm an easy person to be around all the time. And quite frankly, she's not an easy person to be around all the time. She puts up with me in a great way. But you know what? She's an amazing mother. I've got to say, she had never held a child before Jason was born. And she's turned out to be the greatest mom.
What's the thing that bugs you the most? What's the thing that she bugs you
the most? That bugs me the most about Jenna?
Yeah, what's the thing?
How long are we allowed to talk for? I'm kidding, honey, I'm kidding. She doesn't know how to pronounce that S-O-R-R-Y word.
Oh.
Sorry, baby. I'm sorry, but did you heard me say the word, right?
Yes. So what's your favorite music?
Classic rock, you know, Uriah Heep, Zeppelin, Beatles, all that stuff. Boston is greatest ever. And anybody that had long hair in the 80s, the hair metal phase just does it for me.
Nice. If you could talk to any person who's not alive, not a relative, but like a celebrity or someone famous.
Jesus Christ.
Okay.
And I'm not religious. It's interesting. I'm a licensed
minister.
I've done a lot of wedding ceremonies, but I always tell people, I said, listen, if you want the highly religious, very devout one, that's not me. I am not a religious guy at all. But I'd like to hang out with Jesus and find out what exactly was going on back then.
Sure. I mean, that would be interesting. Favorite movie?
Oh, hundreds of them. Literally, listen, when I get to a racetrack, every Thursday night I go see a movie. Every Thursday night. When I get done at the races, I usually try to stay till the car is loaded, but I'll go back and watch something on HBO. I'm an avid movie fan. Shawshank Redemption was tough to beat. Groundhog Day, brilliant. And any good Western.
Westerns, I like that. So what's your favorite TV show?
I thoroughly enjoy the stuff on History Channel, just being able to learn and stay entertained at the same time. While this James Holzhauser had his run on Jeopardy, God, I hadn't watched Jeopardy in 3 years. We were riveted to the TV that somebody could be that knowledgeable and that fast. Like, I knew a tenth of the answers, but I only knew them by hitting pause and going, yeah, I've got that. By that time, all three of them are clicking their buzzer. That guy was just off the charts.
And you know, the sound person on Jeopardy is married to the current Nostalgia Top Fuel champion.
Seriously.
Mandy Fry.
Small world, right?
Yeah, Cole Kuntz, one of our buddies.
Yeah, Cole's a pretty impressive dude.
So when you binge watch something, you know, what's the latest show you've binge watched?
We got Netflix recently. That's not an ad, by the way, but if you want to give us free. So we started getting into some of the series. And the first series, Jenna actually went and bought all the CDs that we got into, was Breaking Bad.
Sure.
And I think it ruined us for every other series. It was so extraordinarily well done that the bar was set too high, and we'd get 5 or 6 episodes into a couple other ones and they weren't watchable. Latest one, we just watched all the Ozark one. That was great.
Oh, yeah.
Stranger Things, pretty cool.
Ozark, the Ozark guys came to the Atlanta race.
I got to meet them, yeah.
How fun was that?
Yeah, no, and you and I get to rub shoulders with a lot of cool people. It doesn't mean I think I'm cool. It means I think I'm fortunate to get to meet a lot of celebrities. And when something's within grasp, it's not as big of an awe moment. But for my wife and mother-in-law, they're like, make sure you get a picture with them and send it in. So I got a picture with them.
So what's the favorite part? What's your favorite part about being a dad?
Oh, gosh. Before I left here, my daughter Layla's 7, and she's got the new thing is she runs and we time her jump, so, and she's just the right weight. And I told her this morning, I said, you know, when your brother was a little younger than you, he rode everywhere on my shoulders. So I think we're all gonna die someday, and you leave a legacy or you leave genetics, you know, and I've got 2 wonderful kids that it's cool to come home. It really is.
Now, how do you relax when you come home? You know, when you're not doing the errands, when you're not taking care of the kids.
I'm a lazy person by nature. And I'm not saying this to be humble. I'm saying this because I'm a lazy person. And I'm married to a woman with OCD that doesn't know the meaning of the word lazy. Jenna is just 24/7 get up and go. I'm probably not really good at relaxing. Surfing's awesome because it kind of forces that, right? The waves aren't coming constantly. I'm pretty good at kicking back on that reclining chair with the remote control.
All right, so last question. Who are some of your heroes besides the one you mentioned before, famous person?
And to sound cliche, it's not, I'm not saying this to fall in line with everybody. I'm saying this because I've matured to the point that I recognize this. My parents, they divorced when I was 10. My mom, Joanne, passed away in 94, but boy, as I look back, how unselfish they both were to do all the things that my brother and I not necessarily wanted to do, but needed to do, and instill a sense of morals and right and wrong and work ethic in us. And then some of the people I met through the Frank Holly School, including Frank, I think he's amazing. I got to induct him into the Hall of Fame, and probably one of the greatest moments in my drag race career in addition to getting to race alongside him in a final round. Just stunning. You picture you play high school football and somebody asks you to go pitch against Stan Musial one time. That's how I felt racing against Frank Hawley. Jim Mills is a retired Air Force colonel and one of my students there. And it just, there are so many situations I get to in a day-to-day life. I'm like, how would Jim handle this? You know, when you just have the urge to choke somebody and you think of somebody who handles everything right. Those type of people are my heroes.
Well, we have a little show and tell. I asked Jack to bring some things into the studio and tell us about this piece of paper.
Well, I didn't know if I was going to be able to find this. I thought I knew where it was. And when I went in my garage attic to rummage through my dad's old magazines, this is my first time slip. This is Lubbock Raceway in Texas, 1986, in my 68 El Camino. I would have been 19 at the time. And went 1506 at 93 miles an hour. Now, eventually that day, I got it down to 1450 at 97 miles an hour. But that is my first time slip. I even wrote notes on the back of it there before I'd done jetting or timing or uncorked the thing. And so that's really what started it. And so it's mind-blowing to me to think that that's 33 years gone by now.
Wow.
It's just stunning because I think I'm that 19-year-old kid till I look in the mirror and I see the gray and the wrinkles, and I think that this is just what comes with wisdom, at least I hope that. But this, at the time, seemed like the culmination of my passion for drag racing. And now when I look back, it was really the start of another
sure.
passion for drag racing.
Now, before we get out of here, he brought in some
Well,
some really
well first
cool,
off, as yeah, I'm thumbing let's... through the magazines, there's my boys. When I got my number for my Top Fuel car, and you could pay extra and get a two-digit number, I got number 71, because that was James Warren's number when he won so many of the division championships. And by the way, check out the wheel skirts. Those should make a comeback.
That's amazing.
2005, a guy's waiting in line for my autograph driving the Top Fuel car, real tall dude, and I get to him, and he didn't say anything, and I hate when people play games. And it was James Warren waiting in line for my autograph.
That is absolutely amazing.
Wow. So my dad, Bob, who I just talked to, he lives outside of Dallas right now, I just talked to on the way up here. My grandfather, Albert, who fought in World War I, my dad was the last of the kids, and he was older when he had me. He bought this for my dad outside of Tampa, Florida when they were on a family trip. So it's August 1950 hot rod. My dad actually started when he was 17 or 18, a car club called the Clockers. Their first meeting ever was in the basement of my grandparents' house at 909 Louisiana Avenue, Cumberland, Maryland. So I just want to bring a magazine that had a mailing label on it. And the Clockers still exist. And then this is a hop-up magazine, which this was the precursor to one of the other big titles. You know, Hot Rod came out in 48, but then hop-up morphed into something else. But my dad was a Hot Rod guy. They had a one-car garage that was a converted railroad office that my grandpa had bought, torn down, brought to their place, and my dad would change engines in the dead of winter off a beam there, doing it old school. He moved to California in 62, took a job with Lockheed because he had a secret security clearance. He interviewed with Wyand and all the speed parts manufacturers because he wanted to be in that trade, and they said, dude, you're wasting your time. You're gonna make way more money working for the aerospace companies. And then along comes my brother Ted, then along comes me, and so, you know, his dreams shifted. And again, I think he just did all the right things for my brother and I. And I love having him come to the races. And he stood in the winner's circle with me a couple times.
That's fantastic. Your dad is very involved on social media.
And he's named himself Slow Bob.
Slow
Go
Bob.
Go figure. Yeah.
Fast Jack, Slow yeah. Bob. Well, Jack, infinite hero, obviously a great cause. We love what you do with the challenge coins and, you know, getting to see Mr. Gary
Linfoot, yeah.
Yeah, Gary's a great guy.
We change lives. You know, we raise yeah. money. The Chandler family pays for everything, for the race car and for the Make-A-Wish car. I just got a picture sent to me today on text, and it was dated 3 years ago, and it was a picture of Gary Linfoot standing with his exosuit at the back of our trailer with the picture of him standing with his exoskeleton and the entire crew and Terry Chandler standing right next to me there. And God, does that's heartache. She died the 4th of July, 2017. But her husband, Doug, recognized that while she was changing the lives of the Make-A-Wish people and the Infinite Hero people, it was also changing her life. And that's why he's, as a legacy to Terry, has extended it at least through next year. And I have a job because of the Chandler family. And we get to change lives because of the Chandlers.
Well, Jack's won three times at Norwalk. Good luck this weekend, and thanks for coming into
always fun hanging out with you.
Our new studio.
And you. Yep, and the producers over there. Thank you, guys. It's cool. It's another pinch me moment for me.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks to Jack Beckman, and thanks for watching NHRA.TV.